So welcome to Beyond Mentoring, engaging mentors in recruitment, fundraising, and beyond. I'm so happy you guys have come here today. This is something I feel extremely passionately about. So I hope that you will be able to walk away with tips and tools and frameworks and a roadmap so that you can do this successfully within your own organization and your own communities. We really want to make sure that our impact is reaching far and wide and we can grow exponentially. So I'm Audrey Siegfried. I am the training manager with Mentor Colorado. Does anybody know Mentor Colorado? Awesome. Good, we have some people. If you're not familiar with Mentor Colorado, are you familiar with mentoring partnerships, state mentoring partnerships? Anybody? Okay, great. This is really great. If you are not connected to your mentoring partnership, please, please, please go to mentoring.org and check if your state has a partnership. Okay? So, what do you know about Mentor Colorado or state partnerships? Anybody? Yes?
They provide support and tools.
They provide support and tools. Excellent. What else?
Our mentoring partnership helps us with quality assurance and program policies.
Awesome. Quality assurance, program policies. Yes? Absolutely. Convening, collaboration, right? Helping to ensure that information, best practices are distributed amongst our peers and amongst each other so we can grow this field. Anybody else?
I also say education.
Education, absolutely. We are really intent upon taking research and the information that we have and helping to educate our mentoring partners, mentoring programs so that you can take that research and implement it, right? Taking research to practice is what our role is, that intermediary role of helping to expand and provide capacity building. So we were founded in April of 2014. Many state partnerships have been around for much, much longer than that. And we are all affiliates of Mentor, the National Mentoring Partnership. So Mentor provides us with all sorts of wonderful resources and information so we can then distribute it amongst our communities and make sure that you have everything you need to be successful. So we're going to do introductions. So I'm going to give you a little bit more background about myself, and then I want you guys to get to know your neighbors a little bit. So I have been with Mentor Colorado for about a year and a half now. I'm the training manager with the organization, so I do all of that capacity building, training, consulting, all of that great stuff. But before that, I managed a mentoring program right here in Washington, D.C., Capital Partners for Education. I've got some representatives. It's a wonderful college success program working with students from the summer prior to ninth grade all the way through college graduation. So it was a wonderful experience overall. I've also done dropout prevention in the city, tutorial programs. I worked at Kelly Miller Middle School in Ward 7. So I worked here in DC for 12 years. I'm very passionate about youth development, and I'm also really passionate about building that community, that exponential growing community of mentoring supporters and advocates. So what I would like everybody to do, because we've got a really big group, so we're not going to go around and all introduce each other, but what I'd like you to do is with the person or two people next to you, I'd like you to let them know who you are, where you're from, what brought you to this session in particular, and one goal that you have that you want to take away from this session to take back to your organization. Okay? All right, we're going to do that for about 2 or 3 minutes. You don't know him.
Thank you.
right, if we could all wrap up our final thoughts. All right, ladies and gentlemen. I love the exuberance, but I'm going to need you to quiet down. I know, it's wonderful. This is a great thing. So do I have any brave souls that would like to share either what brought them here to this session in particular or what they're hoping to gain and take back with them? Maybe three people? Yes, ma'am. Awesome. Great. Yes. Empower your mentors. Absolutely. But they don't know how to do it, right? So let's give them the tools so they can. Yeah. What else? One more. Yes. Fantastic. Absolutely. Help them to engage with the community so the whole community can come together and support the program. Fantastic. Well, I'm hoping that we will accomplish all those things and everything else you have come to see. All right, so how are we going to do this today? So we're trying to take a mentor from being just a mentor to a recruiter, a fundraiser, an advocate, a marketing person. I mean, there are so many different things, an event planner. We can just keep listing the endless possibilities of what these individuals can do. Because as we said, we're not leveraging all of their skills. We're not empowering them to take this opportunity and help it to grow. So here are our key objectives for today. This is what we're going to cover. So first, we're going to talk about what is the point of this? Why aren't we doing this? Why should we be doing this? And if we do, what are our opportunities? What's the actual numbers? What could we get? Next thing we're going to do is we are going to identify your actual team that will be supporting this, okay? So what are the characteristics that make someone who can be an advocate and a recruiter and fundraiser for your organization? And once we figure that out, how do we get them on board, right? How do we convert them from that mentor to the sustained advocate for your organization? All right, next one, preparing your team. So now that we've figured out your team, we're then going to take you and give you the understanding and framework so that you can provide them with tools and the support so that they can effectively execute what you're asking them to do. And then our final thing is we are going to explore options for this. So we're actually going to look at some different activity ideas together, and then you're going to have an activity assessment that you can take back to your organization and utilize with your team that you develop once you've got them in place. So you can effectively assess each of these different options to determine what is going to be the best thing, the easiest thing for you to execute, the most cost effective, and the one that's going to get you the best results. All right, sorry. All right, so what is the point of all of this? Why are we doing this? So what are our goals in this? Does anybody know, like, overall goals of why we want to include mentors in these efforts?
Sustainability.
Absolutely.
Engagement and identity with the organization.
Engagement and identity with the organization, certainly. Anybody else? Yes. They are absolutely the best advocates for your organization. Anybody else have any? Creates buy-in. So all of these things, while they might not be on this slide, some of them are, they will come up in the rest of the workshop when we really talk about these points. Yes. Scale. Okay? I'm big on scale. As my former colleague can tell you, I want to be as efficient as possible and reach as many people as possible. And scale is how we do that, right? But we have to have things in place. So we want to increase, right? Increase everything. Increase funders, increase mentors, increase volunteers and advocates, right? That capacity building, that scale. We want to leverage our resources, okay? We want to use our people power our time more efficiently, and we want to get more done better, right? I want to figure out how to do less and get better results. I'm going to think smarter in this. And the last thing, right? We talked about buy-in. We want to build community. This is a piece that gets missed really often. Mentoring can be a very isolating experience, right? Has anybody ever mentored or taught in a classroom? You've got kids around you all day, and it can be one of the loneliest jobs you ever have, right? So we have to recognize that people are becoming a part of a mentoring community so that they can become a part of something bigger than themselves, so that they can interact with like-minded individuals who are also interested in helping this cause. So building that community will help you to go far and beyond your expectations. Why aren't we doing this? What do you think? Time, paperwork, yes, all right, so time, right? We don't have time. What else?
Resources.
Priorities. Priorities, yeah?
Marriage.
That'll go with the time thing, right? And the prioritization. Anybody else? Awesome. We've covered all of them, okay? Burnout. Right? We are afraid of burning our mentors out. These people are awesome. They're taking time out of their lives to mentor a young person. So how can we ask them to do more than that? We're going to burn them out, and then they can't be mentors. We wouldn't want that, right? But what does the research say? What does surveys say? The more they get involved, the more they want to give. We are losing tons of supporters by not making the ask. People get involved with your organizations because they want to be involved with the cause, not because they want to give an hour here and there. They're devoting 1-2 years to this, right? They want to have a big component of their life dedicated to this. So the research says the opposite of what we think. Time was another one. We have got way too much going on. There are too many things to do in an organization. And we also worry about our mentors' time, right? They're balancing so many different things. They won't have the time to assist. And then our last one, management, right? What are we going to do with them? How do we figure it out? How do we manage the process to ensure it's actually happening and hold them accountable? So why should we be doing this? What's that? It makes you feel good? Why is mentoring organizations, should we be engaging our mentors in this? Yes.
It saves staff time.
Absolutely. Which we take the step back and make the time, it saves us time. They are absolutely our biggest resources. What else?
It widens your universe.
Absolutely. We are small organizations trying to tackle big issues, right? So in Colorado, I'm going to take Colorado for an example because that's where I live and I support. So on average, our mentoring agencies have 6 staff members. 6 staff members that are in charge of recruitment, fundraising, operations, case management, staff support, everything, right? 6 people. And our average mentoring program operates on $300,000 or less a year. But what are the issues we're tackling? Poverty, dropout rates, drugs, gangs, huge issues that we're trying to tackle with 6 people. So we have to leverage our resources. We have to expand our net and get bigger. They know your organization better than anybody else. They can speak to it. They can sell it. They have an intimate experience with mentoring that nobody else has with your organization. They can tell people what it's really like, why they should give their money, why they should become a mentor, why they should have this experience that expands their mind and their knowledge. And the last one, I'm going to emphasize this over and over and over again. They have networks beyond your own. They know people that you don't know.
They work in companies that you don't work in. They are parts of alumni associations, fraternities, sororities, sports, clubs, all sorts of different things. And they have tons of people that they interact with on a daily basis that you will never meet. So giving you an introduction, awesome, right? How many people have had like a corporation where they introduce you to somebody and you do like a lunch and learn? You come in and you do like a little presentation in front of everybody, right? How successful is that?
Very.
Okay, that's great. That's awesome. That is absolutely wonderful. I'm happy to hear that. And I would love to actually see the framework for how you do it. Because most of our programs, what we hear is they get a bunch of people in the room, and then one person becomes a mentor. One person donates money. So it's that conversion, right?
And we have the other problem because we have a sort of a threshold requirement for, like, you need to be a professional woman, very successful.
Not okay.
Very, extremely successful, but contributing in some sort of way. So we have a lot of people who want to, but we have to sort of
back them up a little bit. Okay. So. Fair. All right. Well, that is great, though, that you're having that success.
Very selective.
But with this, though, and then my kind of point with all of this is that they have a voice within those communities that you don't have. They're a member of the community. They're connected with other people. So while an introduction is wonderful, your voice doesn't carry the same weight as theirs. So it's awesome that you're able to kind of leverage that. But most of us get up and we present in front of people, and there are a couple people that may be interested. But if I'm presenting to my coworkers about the organization that I mentor with and why it's important to me and why my young person is the best ever, that's going to change the turnover rate, right? That's going to engage people more. Yes. Absolutely. 100% agree with you. I think that is an excellent point. And that also helps with the transition, right? So they're the ones introducing you with, you know, they're with you, and then the person gets used to this new staff member. That's a great, great point. All right, we're going to look at some statistics right now, because I wanted to really kind of focus on what is our opportunity here. So if we're actually going to do this, what are our chances of getting more people? So according to the Bureau of Labor, 1 in 4 men is currently volunteering. But only 1 in 19 of them is mentoring. Okay? So 1 in 4 recognizes that we need to give back, but only 1 in 19 is choosing mentoring as that option. Women, we're doing a little bit better. So I think most of you, if you do recruitment, you could attest to that. So we have 1 in 3 women who are currently volunteering. But only 1 in 13 is mentoring. So again, we've got this drop-off, right? All of these people who are volunteering who aren't mentoring but recognize the importance of giving back. So what are the odds? All right, we've got these two mentors here. What are the odds that they know some of these people that have already volunteered? Okay? People have already volunteered. That's low-hanging fruit, right? They already get that it's important to be engaged in their communities and to give back. That's not something you have to sell them on. It's just why mentoring is the better choice than something else. Why mentoring is the more impactful intervention. And what are the chances they know any of these other people that haven't volunteered at all over the last year? Volunteering most often happens by chance and opportunity, right? People aren't actively seeking volunteer opportunities often. It's something that falls onto your lap. Your friend tells you about it. Your coworker tells you about it. Oh yeah, I've been thinking about that for a while. So we're talking about peer-to-peer recruitment, fundraising, and advocacy. So does anybody know what peer-to-peer recruitment, fundraising, advocacy? Does anybody know what I'm talking about when I'm talking about that? Yes, sir.
Sure, that's when you convert somebody to an advocate for you, and they reach out to a friend or a neighbor or a
Fantastic. Absolutely. It's converting somebody to an advocate, recruiter, or fundraiser for you, and then them working within their networks to convert their peers to your cause. So let's look at some statistics as to why this is important. So Dr. Susan Weinberger did a webinar the other day. Did anybody see that? On financial sustainability in your organization. So she mentioned this statistic right here. When donors were asked why they gave to an organization, 72% said it's because somebody that they know asked them. Okay, 72%. How many people in here are recruiters? Awesome. So most of you know that most organizations, about 50 to 75% of their recruitment is through word of mouth. Right? People telling other people they know why mentoring is important. Our last one, 23 hours. This is the average number of hours that a person spends emailing, texting, utilizing social media, and communicating via online means every single week. Okay? People are connected to other people. They are dispersing information and communicating with them. We need to take advantage of this. So we're going to look at Facebook as an example. 57% of American adults are on Facebook. And chances are your mentoring population, depending on who you're leveraging, might be more than this, right? Especially if millennials are a huge component. It's probably going to be more than 57%. So more than half of your mentors are connected to other people via Facebook. 338 is the average number of friends that a Facebook user has. So they are connected to 338 other people. Of those users, 64% visit Facebook on a daily basis. And then this one I love. 44% of them are liking or commenting on content that their friends post on a daily basis. So that means that not only are they on Facebook, but they are engaging with their friends' posts, they are reading them, they are liking them, and they are commenting on them. So this is a perfect opportunity to start leveraging these social media sources or other forms of communication, knowing that people are connected in this way. All right, so now we're going to look at how we create our team. So we recognize that our options are really, really expansive, right? If we figure out how to do this right, we can reach exponentially more people than we have ever reached. Whoops. All right, so there's supposed to be an arrow there. I'm not exactly sure where it is, but that's all right. So just imagine a beautiful arrow across the screen. So this is our model for sustained advocacy, because this is essentially what we're trying to create, right? We're trying to take people from mentors for a year, to lifelong advocates, to people who are going to convert many people to supporting your organization. So the first thing we're starting with is this identification piece, right? This is what we're about to work on. We're going to help you to identify your actual team that you're going to utilize to support you. Once we identify them, we're going to talk about how to make them aware of this, how to make the ask to build this team. Then you're going to prepare them. What steps are necessary, what tools are necessary to help them to go out and fundraise and recruit and advocate. Then they're going to go out and do it, and you're going to reinforce it. You're going to support them. You're going to help to hold them accountable. You're going to let them know deadlines and timelines and make sure that they're able to accomplish this. And then the last piece, if you do that well, is you get those sustained advocates, those people who are going to continue promoting for your organization for years and years to come. All right, so how are we going to identify them? So I'm going to ask you guys to close your eyes for a second, because as I walk you through this, I actually want you picturing the mentors that you have that fit this role. All right? So the first thing I want you to think about is your mentors and their actual mentoring relationships. Who is a rock star? Who is going above and beyond any expectation you've had for that mentoring relationship? Who calls you back as soon as you call? Who is following up with you before you even follow up with them? Who is the person who knows how to connect with you, how to ask for help, and how to advocate for their young person. Everybody have one person in mind? All right, we're going to do the next one. Next one is supports, okay? So I want you to picture your mentor who shows up to absolutely every single event that you have. The one who comes early, who asks if they can bring supplies, who stays around to help clean up afterward, who's always, always engaged. Now, this person does not have to have an awesome mentoring relationship. In fact, if you play this right, you can pull in the person who otherwise would leave because they don't have a good mentoring relationship. So think about the people that, despite the fact that they have a good or bad relationship, they're still engaged. They still want to be a part of that community. We got one more. Back to the networks thing. So think about the person that is just connected to everybody. Perhaps they work for a company that you've been trying to find a way to get a partnership with. They're a leader within their community. They're in all sorts of different sports programs and have those networks beyond your own. All right, everybody got those three people?
Three different people.
Yes, that is quite all right. All right, so you guys can open your eyes. So now we're going to do our first activity. So in your activity packets, everybody has this. You are welcome. Anybody else not have a packet? You're welcome. All right. So on the backside of your front sheet is a social capital mapping opportunity. So social capital mapping is looking within your own network and who you are connected to determine who's going to be your team. So again, think about those three mentors you've already come up with. Those are going to be your starting point. So what I want you to do is for the next 2 to 3 minutes, you're going to think about those mentors, but I also want you to think about staff and board members who could support you that aren't, who could be engaged in this team, this overall team you're creating. So you're going to take about 2 to 3 minutes to brainstorm one or two people in each of those categories. So again, it's people who are really great at their role and surpassing all expectations, people who might not be in a great relationship but are engaged anyway, showing up, providing support, and then people who have those networks that you want to tap into, that have voice, that have leadership abilities within those networks. So take about 2 to 3 minutes. Once you are done, I would like you to stand up, and that will help you to see who else is done, and find someone who's finished, connect with them, and I want you to tell them one person you've chosen and the reasons why you chose that person. Yes, sir.
Do they have to be in the organization?
No. It's easier if they are, but if you have a friend that you want to bring into the mix, you already have the relationship with them. I think one other point that I want to make with this is that it's easier if you already have a personal relationship with them.
So much.
You're welcome.
If you haven't started chatting with somebody else, find someone else now and share. We're only going to take about a minute or two more.
Do you mind kind of repeating it because the webcast can't hear them because they don't have microphones?
Yes. Take about one more minute. If we could start finding our way back to our seats.
I'm just going to ask you really quick, where in Colorado are you from?
I live in Denver.
Okay, I'm from Estes Park originally, so I'm not representing them now, but I'm from Estes Park, so
awesome.
Always love Colorado connections.
All right, wrap it up. Two contributors again on this one. So I have two people who would like to share somebody that they came up with that they had never really thought about before, and could you share also the reasons why you think this person would make an awesome team player in your now recruitment, fundraising, or advocacy team? Two people. Yes, sir.
And had her organizational company donate money to us on a continual basis now at this moment. And I think it's time to start utilizing those individuals more so than we are now. And it's amazing how you go to something like this and you just now recognize that, why didn't I see this before? But yeah.
But that's why we're here, right?
That's why we're here. Networking, getting ideas. It's a beautiful thing.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Can I have one more person?
Go. So I actually thought of one of our mentors. He was actually the first mentor ever to sign up for our program. And he's in his 80s. He owns a farm, but he's sort of a pillar in the community. And he's been a rock star. Like, the kid that he mentors is kind of all over the place. He's diagnosed with ODD, borderline conduct disorder, and so there's been just, he was involved with the police before he was in mentoring. He decided that he was done dealing with his mom and moved to a different state to live with his dad, who is extremely abusive, and Frank, his mentor, is the one who actually paid for him to get home when his dad, like, was hurting him again, and so he's just been, like I said, like, a rock star mentor, like above and beyond, and he like sends me ideas. He sends them in the mail because he doesn't do email, but I get like little letters with like ideas and things that might be helpful. And yeah. Frank,
my grandfather still sends me newspaper clippings when he sees things on education. Fantastic. All right, so I'm going to be trying to remember to use this microphone if I can figure out how. Well, we'll get back to that. so that everybody, so we're live casting this, so if I'm repeating things or if I'm bringing the microphone to you so we can make sure that everybody at home is hearing all of your wonderful contributions as well. Because as you said, right, this is an opportunity to start to spark ideas and really think about the things you already have and share with each other about your experiences so that we can all grow from each other. Okay, so now that we've got our team identified, right? We've got the idea about who we want to actually have on board. We've got to make the ask, okay? We have to actually convert them from just this, you know, idea in our minds to being aware that we want them to be on the team and aware of how to become a part of the team. So the first thing that I want to say with this is you need to make it personal. So one, I said it's a lot easier if you already know them, right? But maybe you have another staff member that's really engaged with them and knows them very well. So they could be the person who's really bringing them along. But you want to make it personal. And with this as well, don't send them an email. Don't do an all call. Pick up the phone. Figure out a time when you guys can meet. Take them out for coffee. Have lunch with them. Right? Really make this about them and having that relationship with them. Developing that relationship with them. Next thing. Fit. You want them to understand why they are the perfect fit for your team, why their skill set is going to contribute so much to what you're doing, and why you think they're awesome, right? There's a reason you've selected these individuals. Let them know that. The very last thing is to overcome objections. And now, really, overcoming the objections is not trying to strong-arm somebody or convince them to do something that they don't want to do. This is just helping them to see why it fits and aligns with their lifestyle, why they are someone who can contribute exceptional things, and why they actually do have the time to be a part of this, though they might not think that they do. So we've got our team, right? Everybody selected the individuals they want on this team. You've gone out, you've had coffee with them, lunch with them. They're on board. They can't wait. So how are we going to prepare them? How are we going to get them ready for this? You're going to arm your army. That's how you're going to do it. You're going to give them all of the equipment, all of the training, and all of the tools so that they are actively working for you. So the first thing you need to do is develop talking points or help them to develop those talking points. My recommendation is have them be a part of this, right? Take them through the steps of thinking about what the main points are, what their selling points will be, what they want to highlight, the importance of this. It's much better when it's generated from within so that they come up with the ideas and collectively figure out what their voice will be. It's templates and e-materials, template emails, flyers, all of that fun, jazzy stuff. You need to create it for them. And the reason is because if we give them another thing to do, that's one more opportunity for them not to do it. So you have to streamline and ease this process for them. You're asking them to distribute the information, not create it. And you can create templates that are ones that can be changed and manipulated to use their story and their voice, right? Just give them this framework that they can then change for their audience. So the final thing, specifics. How many people are you trying to recruit? How much money are you trying to raise? What is the purpose of your advocacy? Are you trying to push legislation? What's the deadline for this? What's the plan going to be? Who are they reaching out to? Again, if you give them barriers, it gives them chances to drop off. If you tell them all of the things to do, they can meet your expectations and surpass them. So now we're going to look at examples of each. So I've given you examples of each of these. Again, I said, you're gonna get your team, you're gonna get tools, and you're gonna go home and be able to do this. So let's look at the first one, talking points. We're gonna work on your sales pitch. How many people here are familiar with an elevator pitch? Everybody, of course. What are the downfalls of an elevator pitch? It sounds like an elevator pitch, absolutely, right? It's a monologue. You are talking at people. So it just ends up being a showcase rather than a dialogue, a conversation. So I use the term sales pitch, because if you know sales, it's about communicating with your audience. It's about finding out what their needs are and meeting them. So this is a conversation. This is an engaging interaction. This is not just talking at somebody. So in each of your packets, I've given you a little framework for what you can use with your team when you get back to your organization and you've identified them. This is a great starting point to help to prepare them to feel confident and be able to talk about your organization successfully for whatever it is that you decide you'd like them to help you with. So, a couple things, key points. You are trying to engender and create interest and action. It's getting them jazzed up and excited about this, and then actually taking it and doing something with it, right? And then the other things we need to remember with this is that it needs to be memorable. People need to be able to remember what it is that you're trying to accomplish and why your organization stands out. We're all really used to, in elevator pitches, trying to differentiate ourselves from other mentoring organizations. We're not competing with other mentoring organizations. We're competing with other causes, and we're competing with other things that occupy people's time. So we need to get past this idea that we have to differentiate ourselves from other mentoring programs and differentiate ourselves as a field. Why is mentoring different than any other intervention? Why is this something that your mentors should be engaged in beyond mentoring, and why should other people be engaged in these activities? So what we're going to do for the next couple minutes is actually the second step in this. And the second step is generating questions. Okay? You want to engage in questions with them. So I'm going to give you an example, and then I'm going to set you free for a couple minutes to work with either a partner next to you or a couple people next to you, whatever works best for you, and to generate a list of questions that you could ask. You could have your mentors ask other people to engage them in this conversation that will then take them to the point where they want to become a mentor, a donor, or another advocate for your organization. All right, so here's an example. I quite often find myself talking about my job. And so I'll be talking about mentoring and what I do in mentoring, and then I might segue that into, have you ever thought about mentoring before? It's a really easy lead-in, right? Everybody's asked that question at some point. And we can get a little bit of resistance sometimes. I absolutely have thought about mentoring, but you know what? I just don't have the time. Anybody heard that one before? All the time, right? That's like the second thing that comes. So they just don't have the time. Can anybody think of a lead-up or a follow-up question to that? How much time do you think it requires? Excellent, right? Then they start to talk a little bit more. My favorite one to go to from that is, what are you doing this weekend? So, what are they doing this weekend? Well, I'm going to go to grocery shopping on Saturday, and then I'm going to hit the gym, maybe go to a film festival, might walk around a little bit. Going grocery shopping? You could take your mentee with you. You're going to go to the gym? You could take your mentee with you there, too. A little walk around? You could take your mentee with you. Right? How do they not have the time anymore? Everything that they've just told you they're doing, they can take their mentee with them. So you start to break down those barriers, those objections. Once you overcome those objections, then you've got someone who's converted, right? So, next 3 minutes or so, I want you to work in those small groups and start to brainstorm questions that you or your mentors could ask other people to engage them in conversation to eventually get them to the point of becoming a mentor, a donor, an advocate. All right, go to it.
whichever one you were using before.
I think it was
this one. Yeah, that's a good one. Yeah, number two.
All right, are we ready to roll? So everybody's got some awesome questions now, right? Wrap up those conversations. All right, well, since there's so many people who had so many things to say, that must mean we have a couple people who would like to share some of the questions they came up with. So can I get three? Three people who would like to tell me at least one question that they came up with that they just think is awesome. Oh, I like being voluntold things.
My question is, I would ask, growing up, did they have a mentor in their life? So with the chance of them having a mentor, it'll give a better possibility to ask to volunteer and become a mentor.
Absolutely. They can speak to the mentoring experience that they had, and you can connect with them on that personal level again and relate that.
I'm not volunteering. I'm just like, I'm piggybacking off of what you were saying. Instead of using the word mentor, use the word caring adult. Because a lot of times people equate mentorship in a way different capacity than it is. So just say, well, did you have a caring adult growing up? And then talk to them about that caring adult and the activities that that caring adult did.
Awesome. So I'm going to repeat that for our viewers at home. So, and what was your name?
Zuri.
Zuri. So Zuri was saying that it's really important to think about the audience and the language that we use. So on that document that I gave you, one of the steps is getting to know your audience, right? And so she said that for some people, the word mentor or mentorship can have connotations that are kind of outside of the realm of what you're actually talking about. And so being able to recognize who your audience is and switch up the language, so she used caring adult, which is an excellent opportunity. It could be coach, it could be a number of different things, right? But thinking about what is going to resonate more with the person that you are talking to versus maintaining this very strict boundary of language that you use. So really be malleable in your approach and think about that audience and what's going to reach them best, what's going to resonate with them. Yes, sir.
My organization is involved in education. So the first question I always ask is, how important do you think education is for the country and for the person living in Mexico? And they always say it's wonderful. And the second question is, what are you doing about it?
Excellent.
And from there we take it.
Excellent. What is your action? What are you doing, right? We live in a world where people like to talk about issues on social media all the time. But talking about something is a lot different from doing something. So the challenge, right? Challenging somebody, that's great that you think that that is something that we need to address. What are you going to do? How are you going to be a part of this? Awesome. I'll get one more.
My program is a little unique, and we do mentoring in a team. And so a lot of people hesitate because they don't want to be a mentor for the first time by themselves. So one of our questions is, do you have a friend or a coworker that you want to mentor or volunteer with? And then that usually makes people more interested in being a mentor.
That's awesome. Absolutely. Do you have anybody else that you want to do this with? Okay. When I was managing a mentoring program, I saw that all the time, right? People came in groups. They wanted to do things as friends, as coworkers. Think about that in the immediate part of this, right? If they're coming in, immediately ask, do you have other people that you think could contribute to this? Do you know anybody else who might make a great mentor or that you want to hang out with your mentee as well? Okay, excellent. So that's a starting point, right? You can take this framework back with you and use this with your team. Oops. Sorry, one more thing. In your packets, I told you I'm going to give you examples of each of these. So in your packets, the next document that you have after this sales pitch is a template email, right? We are going to provide templates to you as well. So this is something that I used to help to recruit more mentors when I was recruiting. It gives specifics. How many people we want to recruit, when we want them recruited by, exactly what your mentors can do to assist. Now, you can design this for fundraising, for advocacy, for whatever you want. Plug and play. If you want a copy of this Word document, just shoot me an email and you can have at it whatever you want to do with it. But this is to give you some guidance and idea. Now, to take this to the next level, instead of you sending this to your mentors, you get your team to send it, right? Peer-to-peer, they're mentors, they're reaching out to other mentors to then engage them. Last thing in your packet, that final resource, and that's an example. Here's a list of different networks that you could recommend to them. Think about social media. There are so many different things beyond Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn. Who uses Reddit for recruitment? Okay? Reddit is a huge thing, right? People love engaging in that. And so there are all sorts of different social media locations, online locations, listservs, communities that your mentors are a part of already. Yes, ma'am. Reddit is a social media site that doesn't really have rules, if you will. And so people post very open dialogue and conversation on it. And so it's just a slightly rebellious, if you will, form of social media. But it's really, really growing. And for those of our agencies that use it to do recruitment, they have excellent results because it's a community. It's a community of engaged individuals. Hold on, let me grab the microphone so we can get these questions back to you in a second. Yes, ma'am.
I just thought of one. Next door.
Next door, yes. Who's heard of Next Door?
It's a neighborhood one, so and people are usually always on it because they want to know what's going on in their neighborhood.
Absolutely. So Nextdoor is another social media site. You can only be engaged with your neighborhood on it. So this is why you really need to utilize your mentors. You can't be in every single neighborhood on Nextdoor. Your mentors need to be. And it's everything that's going on in that community. Fantastic. Anybody else? Athlinks? It's an athlete-oriented, like sports-oriented social media site. So I've given you a bunch of examples. Some of these are really mainstream, obviously, and then some of them are some of the more niche kind of activity-oriented social media sites. But really, this is just to give you examples of the types of things that you can tap into. Listservs and community, Google Groups, Yahoo Groups, all of that, another great thing to tap into. If you're not a member of them, again, your mentors are going to be members. All right. Any questions about how we're going to arm our army and prepare our mentors? All right, great. So now, how are we going to support them? So we've identified them. We've made the ask. We've got a team. We've now given them the tools so they can effectively do this. So how do we support their efforts? This is the message that we want our mentors hearing. Support the cause you love doing what you love. The support piece comes in helping to ensure that the opportunities that you're talking about are ones that they can do and that they want to do. How are we going to engage that team? I've got the three A's of team engagement. First one, it aligns. It aligns and fits with their interests, their values, and their lifestyle. What you are providing to them and what you are promoting and hoping they will do is something that aligns with what they want to do. The next one we've got, appeals. It's appealing to them. They want to do it. And not only is it appealing to them, it's appealing to their networks. Right? These networks. I keep talking about these networks. It's something that their networks want to engage in. And then the last one is that it's accessible. It has to be something that people can do and do easily. low cost, not a lot of time, not difficult for people to get to. You have to make it accessible. So let's look at some options for this. So the first one, and all of these can be used as recruitment opportunities, as fundraising opportunities, and as advocacy opportunities. And if we want to talk about other things, we can talk about other ones too. There's a lot of different things that you can utilize this for. So the first one I want to look at is the mixers and small dollar fundraisers. We're going to talk a little bit more. I'm going to give you a further example after we get past this slide. But how many people in here have done a friendraiser before? Okay? Friendraiser is when you ask your mentors to bring a friend to possibly become another mentor. Okay? So that's a small example of what that could be. We're going to talk through the small dollar fundraiser a little bit more in a second so you can see how you can use that not only for fundraising but also recruitment opportunities. The next one we've got, special events, birthdays, and dinner parties. Your mentors engage with their friends in social settings, right? They have birthday parties. So maybe suggest to your mentors that instead of getting a bottle of wine from their friends for their birthday, they make a donation to the organization that they're mentoring with. Or they commit a year of mentoring as a birthday present. You really love me? Come on with me. Next one, races, activity-a-thons, and competitions. Our mentors are actively engaged in various pursuits, right? How many of your mentors have run a 5K before or done a bike race? Hike to 14er if you're from Colorado. All right, they do lots of different stuff. We had a mentor, I'm gonna name her actually because I love her so much, Emily Field, and she was a marathon runner. She ran the Marine Corps Marathon here in DC almost every single year. And what did she do around that Marine Corps Marathon time? She raised money for CPE. So she took something she was gonna do anyway, and she leveraged it. She spread information throughout her community and her friends, and she raised about $1,500 each time just by running a race that she was already going to run. So by providing your mentors with tools, they can leverage the things that they're already doing, right? Support the cause you love by doing what you love. And our last one is online platforms. Now, social media is obviously something that we are talking about a lot today and something that I'm sure is on your mind all the time. But the difficulty is that we have gotten really good at putting information out there, but we're not actually giving it to the right sources necessarily, right? We are increasing visibility, but not our donors or our mentors. So it's about understanding how to utilize these platforms effectively. And again, that's a peer-to-peer. So we're going to look at an example now of the small dollar fundraisers. I'm just going to walk you through this example so that you can see what we did as CPE and how that worked out. So we had an amazing mentor leadership council. We started out as a mentor committee. I decided to ramp it up and give them the real recognition that they deserve for the work that they were doing. So they became our mentor leadership council. And these individuals were veteran mentors. Varying degrees of relationship development in terms of their actual mentoring relationships, but all engaged and ambassadors for what we were doing. So what we did together is we determined where we were going to have the small dollar fundraiser. So backstory to this too, we decided to raise money because we really wanted t-shirts that said CPE mentors so people could identify us and how cool we were. Unfortunately, as many of you knew, t-shirts weren't really in the budget that year. So we had to figure out how to raise the money ourselves. So our mentor leadership council was like, well, let's do a small dollar fundraiser. Let's figure out a way that we can get a little bit of funding so we can get these t-shirts for our mentors. So we figured out a location, and we kind of went to a few different bars and asked them if they would do one of the following three things. And this is what you want to look for if you decide to do the small dollar fundraiser happy hour mixer. Can we guest bartend, and then we can take the tips? Right, that's one option. Second option is, will you donate part of the proceeds during this time period to our organization? Those bars and restaurants that will do that usually will give about 10 to 20% of the proceeds made during that time to your organization. And the last option is, can we take a small donation from these individuals and have you extend the happy hour specials. So each of those options totally works. The first time we did it, we were guest bartenders. It was a lot of fun. I was horrible at it. And then the second time we did it, we did the small dollar, took a donation, and then extended the happy hour specials. So we figured out what location we wanted to do it at, and if you're from DC, we did it at Thomas Foolery, was the first place we did, which has all sorts of fun games, and we took over the whole place. And so for the bar, it's a great deal because it generates business on off nights or off time periods, so it's a win for them. They love the visibility and getting more exposure, and being a supporter of an organization is always a great thing. So we figured out our location. And just the logistics, right? Really working through the details and did this as a team. The next thing we did was we developed those template emails and e-marketing materials, right? We got ourselves set up for success so that when we prepared our mentors to go out and get other people to this fundraiser, they had all of the information they needed, all of the tools, the dates, everything was ready to go. And then they just dispersed the information. They did all of the recruitment for the event. And then we supported them, right? If they had questions, if they had people that wanted to talk more about it, if they wanted more talking points, we were there to support them. So we had a great success, right? Both of those events, we had a ton of success. First one, we made about $550. Next one, we made about the same. We had barely any work that we as a staff had to do other than helping to develop these different materials. But when it came to actually getting people out there, our mentors did all of the work. Now, what we didn't really realize in this is that it would be a great opportunity to bring new people into the mix, particularly men. So by telling our male mentors to go and recruit their male friends to give $5, $10 donation, these gentlemen thought, great, I can give to a good cause, and all I have to do is take 2 hours drinking, which I already would have been doing. What they didn't realize is that when you're around 50 people who think mentoring is the coolest thing in the whole wide world, you want a mentor afterward as well. So we made money, we didn't spend a dime on these events, and we recruited 10 to 15 people every single time. And they were awesome. They couldn't wait to get started in those mentoring relationships. So this is just an example of what you can do. Online platforms. I wanted to bring up a couple that can be utilized. So these first three, Classy, Razoo, Donor Drive. Anybody heard of any of these or use any of these? Awesome, okay? These are peer-to-peer fundraising platforms. They've created it all for you. So they have costs attached to them, yes. However, some of them also have the option that individuals can create their own pages. So an organization can buy a package, or an individual can create their own page outside of that if they want to kind of promote a cause or develop fundraising, recruitment, whatever it may be. So those are a couple to check out. One of the resources I'm going to list at the end is Classy Resources. They have all sorts of tips and tools for how to do this peer-to-peer recruitment and fundraising. Our last three, and there's actually one other that we can add to this, but LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, and I'm going to add Instagram in there. If you're going to use social media, these are great, great tools. But again, it's providing your mentors with the tools, the e-materials, so they can do the work for you, and they can work within their own networks. All right. So the very last thing we're going to look at, and then we've got about 10 to 15 minutes for questions at the end. This is the activity that you are going to take home with you to your organizations. So in each of your packets, you have an assessment tool. So this is to assess those different options we came up with or anything else you can brainstorm around this. So when you get back to your organization and you've got your team in place, you meet first, second, whatever time it is, and you sit down with them and you brainstorm a list of these activities that you could do with them, these recruitment activities, these fundraising activities, these advocacy activities. You brainstorm your list and then you have a tool to assess it. So what you're going to think about is, what is the activity? What is the cost associated with this? And I want you to think far beyond the financial cost. The financial cost is important, but staff time. How much time is it going to take for staff? How much time is it going to take for your mentors and anybody else that's involved in this? What's the pain of this? Why is this difficult? Why is this challenging? What are the barriers to your success in this situation? And how could you overcome them? Are they things that you can overcome? Is it a resource issue? Is it a timing issue? Is it a skill issue? What is it? How are you going to address it? And the final piece of this is, what's the gain? So if you do all of these things, what are you going to gain from the situation? So my last question to you before we go into our questions is, from these things that you've heard today, what do you feel that you can do with your organization at this point? What can you take away from today and do immediately when you get back?
I'm going to have we have a lot of interns at our organization. I'm the development director for Youth Build in Bloomington, Illinois. But I have a marketing and a PR intern right now, and he's doing great things, but they're all seniors in college, but they're all over 21. I'm going to have them do that happy hour mixer, because they all go out and party anyway. So why
Absolutely.
Not let us get the money?
They're
going to
do it. Why not get something out of it?
I mean, that's awesome.
Fantastic. Yes, sir.
I recognize that I know my organization inside and out, and I'm surprised when my mentors ask me, like, what do I say if somebody asks me about mentoring or donating? And I realize it's been a theme that I need to develop my talking points really clear, succinct, that I can give out to them so that they know what to say. And
Absolutely. Absolutely. So you bring up a really great point that I want to make sure we emphasize. Mentors need that confidence booster. It's not that they don't know it or don't have the skills, it's that they need somebody to support them to say, you've got this. Help them to figure out the talking points and the tools so that they feel confident going into it. I'm gonna digress for 2 seconds, but one of the things that we know in terms of training of why mentoring relationships last is that trainings provide mentors with a feeling of confidence in those relationships. They're going into the relationship feeling like they know what they're doing. And that, in turn, turns over to longevity in a relationship. Long-sustaining relationships, better relationships. Okay? It's the same thing with manning them and arming them to go out and do this for you. You need to help them to feel confident. So when they go out there, they're not second-guessing themselves. They're ready to go. Anybody else? One other person.
Anything? Probably create talking points for our mentors in like a workshop format or something like that, so they can have organic conversations with their networks.
Fantastic. Wonderful. A workshop, yes. So it actually should be uploaded to the app. Yes, so I have both the slides as well as the activity packet uploaded there. But on my profile, you'll see I have my Facebook, my LinkedIn, my email address, everything that you want to get in contact with me. I have tons of templates that I would love to share with people. Yes?
Can you elaborate on the races, activity-a-thons, and competitions? How do our mentors advocate for us through that? Because if you're competing in a race, you're usually raising money for that cause, so I'm not sure that I completely understood.
Sure. So some you might be raising, so some, like a breast cancer walk, you're raising money specifically for breast cancer. However, there, like in the DC metro area, we have all of these 5K runs that have no real thing that the individual runner is raising for. So the money in the end that they generate will go to one or two causes that they support, but the individual runners are just paying the $40 to register and run. So it's those types of raises and opportunities. There are certainly ones, Race for the Cure. There are so many things that already have that kind of built in, that fundraising component built in. But for those that don't, those are the ones to take advantage of. And if you have people that are really into running, they're probably enrolling in multiple 5Ks just to run. Yes, absolutely. Give me one more second. So I'm going to hit this last slide, and then we're going to do questions and answers. Okay. So with all of these things in place, right, do you guys remember the slide we had before of if we've got two people, how many people can they reach? Now that we've got these tools, we can reach a whole lot more, right? Not everybody is going to be a great mentor. We know that. But there are a lot more that have the skill set, the experience, and the ability to be mentors that we're not reaching. And with these tools, we're going to reach a whole lot more people. Recruitment, fundraising, advocacy, whatever it is. Now let's go to Q&A. All right, back here. Okay, could you just speak into the microphone? Thank you.
Hi, everybody. I was thinking about the spring. I'm planning a kickball event. The organization I work for works with youth. And so we were going to do like a kickball tournament with the youth and the mentors. But that would be a good way to have our current mentors bring in, because a lot of our mentors are college students. So that would be a great way for them to bring friends to just play with the mentees that are there in our program. And also, this just came to me. But having, we partner with a school. So having the staff with the school come out to either play on the student side or play with the mentor side or just mix it up and, again, having a fun activity but getting them to be recruited for the program but not knowing that they're recruited
Absolutely.
For the program.
Absolutely. It's the underlying idea, yes. That is an awesome idea. Has anybody ever done a mentor-mentee kickball, basketball, anything like that event? How much fun is it? It's just about the greatest thing you're going to do. With golf?
Yeah.
Was it awesome?
Yes.
Everybody loves it, right? Everybody loves that. We used to do that activity at our back-to-school bash in Spring Fling. We'd have one something. We did flag football. We did kickball. We did basketball, all sorts of things. Kids came to workshops just so they could play those games. And the competition that ended up going, people were bringing in friends, right? It's a fun activity. And as you said, once they're involved, once they're engaged, they want to do more. All right, other questions? Thank you.
Thank you. I have more of a comment than a question. Two things, resources. My Brother's Keeper, serve.gov is a great resource for mentoring.
Yes.
And also, when you were talking about online, I didn't know if you were aware of generosity.com.
I do not know generosity.com.
Yeah, we've raised over approximately $8,000 between October and November just through generosity. It's very
Everybody
low cost.
Everybody write that down.
Yeah, I mean, it's very low cost. It's set up user-friendly, templates in place, and sort of a version of GoFundMe, but very easily
awesome.
Done.
Awesome. Fantastic.
Generosity.com.
Generosity.com.
I'm not plugging them. We have no relationship.
Okay.
Indiegogo, a nonprofit option, and it's
generous. So, it's a nonprofit version of Indiegogo.
Yes.
And My Brother's Keeper, if you are not on Mentoring Connector, I'm about to bully you to get on Mentoring Connector. So, Mentoring Connector is National Mentoring Partnership's new database for all things mentor recruitment. It is linked to My Brother's Keeper, serve.gov, LinkedIn. There are so many different ads, PSAs, all of those NBA PSAs, they lead you right to Mentoring Connector. So if you are not on it, get on it right after today. Other questions? Nobody else? Yes, ma'am. Support the cause? Support the cause, you love doing what you love? Okay, so if we don't have any more questions, I will be here for about 15 to 30 more minutes to answer any questions that you do have. And my contact information right here. Email me, follow us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter. And then right after this is a resource page of some various resources that I would love for you to check out. They're great. They're great tools. So everybody's got my contact info. My middle name is Love, yes. So also, if you have the app for the summit, I've uploaded the slides of this as well as that activity packet. But if you don't have it and don't have access to it, email me. I also have my business card up here if you want to grab that. I will give you whatever you want in terms of this stuff.
May I?
Absolutely.